Okay, our next speaker, Alexander Medley from Sobolev Institute of Mathematics. He will speak about volumes of polyhedra in spaces of constant curvature and its application to the knot theory.
First of all, thank you very much to organizing committee and also to Euler Institute for kind invitation to this conference. This is very important for me. Viktor Andreevich Topanogov was my teacher in the differential geometry. It was 50 years ago, but I still keep the notice of his lecture. Okay, so the subject of my lecture is volume of polyhedra in spaces of constant curvature and the application to the knot theory. Okay, the beginning of story is very similar to those in the lecture of Professor Vesnin, but of course this is a common part. Mostly we will deal with the Euclidean geometry. This means that the curvature is every time is equal to zero, but sometimes we deal with the spherical geometry. In this case, the curvature, sectional curvature is fixed and is greater than zero. And one more subject is hyperbolic geometry with negative curvature. Everybody knows that first geometry was investigated by Euclid. The second probably was studied by Riemann, but I'm not sure, probably it was known very, very many years ago because people use them in different fields related with traveling. But at the same time, there are more geometries in three-dimensional case. All of them are mentioned in the previous lecture. And also, Thurston geometrical conjecture is well known. This means that any three-dimensional manifold can be decomposed into pieces, and each of these pieces can be modeled in one of the eight above mentioned geometries. This conjecture was solved by Grigory Perelman, and as a consequence of this conjecture, of the solution of this conjecture, he proved the famous Poincaré conjecture, which told us that any closed three-dimensional manifold with trivial fundamental group is the sphere. This is, of course, very general facts. I need more specific kind of geometrical object. This is so-called cone manifolds. The general definition is given here, but probably I need just a few words to explain what is the meaning of definition. What is cone manifold, n-dimensional cone manifold? This is some geometrical object which is obtained from the number of tetrahedral simplexes. Each of these simplexes is modeled in very particular fixed geometry, say hyperbolic, spherical, or geometry. And all of these tetrahedra are glued together, so-called in face-by-face manner. As a result, inside of each tetrahedra, we have already a geometry. And also this geometry is keeping on the face of each of tetrahedra. But the problem is ages of this tetrahedra. If we consider a total angle around the edge of this complex, it's maybe not necessarily equal to 2 pi. So we have a singular geometrical structure along some edges. These edges form exactly a singular set of our cone manifold. And in our lecture, we suppose that this singular set every time is a knot or link. So this is a union of circles. And also we suppose that total space, topological space of this complex is every time three-dimensional sphere. So we consider three-dimensional sphere, and inside the singular set, which is knot or link. Outside of this knot or link, every time we have a fixed geometry of the constant curvature. Okay, this is a typical example. The first part of the picture give us an example of tetrahedra modeled in spherical geometry. This tetrahedra has a number of dihedral angles. This is dihedral angles equal to alpha, another one is equal to beta, and dihedral angles along of black edges supposed to be equal pi over 2. Then we have to identify the faces of this tetrahedra by rotation. For the red case, we used alpha rotation. In the second case, for blue edges, we used beta rotation. After this identification, we topologically get a three-dimensional sphere, but inside of this sphere, we have a singular set formed by red and blue edges. Together, they give us so-called Hopfling. But each of this component of Hopfling already admit a singularity. Total angle around the red angle is alpha, and total angle about around the beta angle is beta. So we have a typical example of quant manifold modeled in the spherical geometry. Okay, now we prefer to deal with some calculation related with the volumes. To do this in the hyperbolic and spherical spaces, we have used so-called Schlaeffle differential equation. K is curvature, is fixed in our consideration. Then the differential of volume of quant manifold under consideration is given by the very simple expression. Every time L sub alpha is just a length of H with total angle alpha around, and this is differential of angle. So we have to take a sum of all components of singular set to get this formula. Now to find volume formula, we have just integrate this differential form. Of course, it's easy to put the integral sign, but how to find this number explicitly, this is a quite difficult story. In the above example of Hopfling, we fix the curvature equal to plus minus one. Then one can easily recognize from the picture that the H labeled by alpha has a length exactly beta, and another length labeled by beta has a length equal to alpha. As a result, the Schlaeffle differential formula has the following simple form. After integration and suitable constant of integration, we have the following simple formula. So this is the first result related with volume calculations for orbifolds, for quant manifolds, modeled in spherical space. Okay, more general case. Let me consider so-called trefoil knot. It's shown on this picture. And now we suppose that it's already inside of three-dimensional sphere. Outside is some geometry of constant curvature, and the total angle around the component of this knot is alpha. It's well known that this knot, in some sense, is not geometrical, because according to the Thurston theorem, the complement of this knot has no hyperbolic structure. But in the same time, there are many other geometries related with this knot. Indeed, quite a long time ago, Seyfert and Weber constructed the so-called spherical space of dodecahedra, also known as the Poincaré homological sphere. It was constructed as a fold covering of the sphere branched over the trefoil. So this means in our language that quant manifold, trefoil with quant angle 2 pi over phi, has a spherical structure. Poincaré homological sphere is very interesting object in geometry because the first statement of the famous Poincaré theorem was, suppose that the first homology of manifold is equal to zero, is it sphere or not? Of course, this is not true, and Poincaré himself constructed such an example. This is exactly this example, described in slightly different terms. Okay, now, if we consider different quant angles related with threefold, then we have a lot of geometrical structure. Indeed, if the quant angle is of the type 2 pi over n, when n is natural number, we have just a geometrical representation. So our object can be represented as a space X3 divided by action of the discrete group. And if this n is sufficiently small, less or equal to phi, we have again a spherical structure. For n6, we have a more complicated PSL 2L structure for n equal to more than 6. And for 6, we have a new structure in this situation. Surprisingly, but the complement of the trefoil, which has no hyperbolic structure, it admits two different structures, simultaneously two different structures. These respective geometries are given on this slide. Recently, a group of young researchers from Novosibirsk Scientific Center and Tomsk University described that torus knot with additional bridge can be modeled also in Euclidean spherical and hyperbolic geometries. Okay, so now the following result is valid in the spherical geometry. Suppose that cone angles is between these two constants. Then there exists a spherical structure of this cone manifold, and moreover, the volume of this spherical structure is given by the following polynomial. This is angle. The proof is quite elementary, but in the same time, he used very strange model for three-dimensional sphere. We provide the unit sphere sitting in the complex two-space by the following Riemannian metric. We have complex numbers, this is Hermitian metric indeed. And lambda is very particular parameter which depends from the alpha. As a result, we have just a model of three-dimensional sphere with a constant curvature plus one. Okay, then the trefoil under consideration has the following fundamental set. It can be obtained by A and B rotation, which identifies the pair of the respective faces. Very interesting that coordinates of this polyhedra in a four-dimensional complex case can be defined very explicitly. They depend just from the angle. So this is complex two-dimensional space or a real four-dimensional space. Of course, it's a projective model. Because these coordinates and also a very explicit form of the metric, we can easily calculate the lengths of our knot. By elementary calculation, we have the following expression. Now we have to solve the Schlafly differential equation, which is elementary in this case. After the integration and find the suitable constant of integration, we have exactly the statement of our theorem. So, in some sense, the spherical geometry is quite simple if we deal at least with the so-called toric knot. Now we consider a bit more complicated consideration. This is a figure 8 knot, which was also mentioned in the previous lecture. We can easily find it on the picture. It has, of course, a hyperbolic structure on its complement. It was described in the previous lecture. And also, also, some years ago, it was described in the paper by Kim Helling and Menicke, then n-fold covering, n-fold branch covering over figure 8 knot give us a very beautiful example of hyperbolic Fibonacci manifolds. So, investigation of geometrical structure on the figure 8 knot has a certain sense. Well, what we have to say here, first of all, this is some results related with the existence of geometrical structure. If cone angle is sufficiently small, between 0 and 2 pi over 3, we have a hyperbolic structure. In the one point, alpha 0 equal to pi over 3, we have a Euclidean structure. And for big angles, at least in these limits, we have a spherical structure. This is valid for spaces of constant curvature, but other geometries, more exotic geometries, were investigated in papers by Horsten, Dunbar, Molnar, joint paper of Molnar, Shimari, and Vesnin. I should note that Kartan, Alexandrov, and Topanogov technology is widely used in investigation of such of objects. This is not subject of my lecture, but this is actually is true. Okay, now what about volumes? If we consider our figure 8 knot again, and suppose that angle is small, so we have a hyperbolic structure, then the volume of hyperbolic structure is given by the following simple expression. In the Euclidean space, In order to calculate the volume, we have to fix a scale, masштаб. So as a unit of length, we suppose to get a length of not itself. As a result, we have the following very simple expression. So this in some sense is reduced volume of our manifold if we fix a unit of length as a length of not itself. In the hyperbolic case, the formula is quite simple. In the spherical case, it's similarly to the previous one. We have to change arccos hyperbolic to the usual arccos. But this function, unfortunately, is multi-valued analytical function. He has one analytical branch up to pi and another analytical branch for pi angle greater than pi. This is just relation between two analytical branches of the same analytical function. In any case, the problem of volume calculation in spaces of constant curvature is completely solved for this particular link. Okay, I want to show just a fundamental set related with the figure 8 node. It can be realized in each of three spaces of constant curvature. Very beautiful polyhedra, so we are able to calculate all geometrical parameters for it in our consideration. The second guy, this is so-called 5-2 knot shown on this picture. Indeed, some years ago when Thurston result about knots was not done, it was paper published by Best, English mathematician, who constructed a very particular kind of orbifold. The underlying space of this orbifold was three-dimensional sphere, and the singular space was exactly this guy. Cone angle in this case was 2 pi over 3. The fundamental set of this cone manifold was exactly regular tetrahedra sitting in regular cube sitting exactly in hyperbolic space. Diedral angle of this cube was exactly 2 pi over 5. Okay, now it's known much more about geometrical structure of this knot. Probably I avoid some details because of time. One of the interesting results is just the complement to this knot 5-2 is a union of three congruent ideal hyperbolic tetrahedra. But these tetrahedra are not regular anymore. Some very particular tetrahedra, which are isometric to each other. Okay, now, what we have to say about geometrical structure of this orbifold. Again, if angle is small, between some limits, where limits is given by very explicit formula, we have a hyperbolic structure. In this particular point, the structure is exactly Euclidean, and for bigger angle, we have a spherical structure. This is just existence theory. Now, what about volume calculation? Well, again, if we consider angle which give us exactly hyperbolic structure, then the volume of this hyperbolic structure is given by the following complex integral. So we have to integrate some very particular functions, and limit of integration are root of some particular cubic equations. There are three roots, two complex conjugated, they are exactly the limit of our integral, and one real root which is outside of our consideration. So this formula is true, and what is maybe not so surprising, but is more or less a new result, if we consider bigger angle, then the spherical volume of this cone manifold is given by the similar integral. Now there are no complex numbers anymore, complex I disappeared. Again, Z1 and Z2 are root of the same cubic equation, but now this cubic equation has three real roots. We are interested only of two of them, which are greater than minus one. The third one, I think, is very, very small, minus six or something like that. Again, we have two possibilities. The first formula is valid up to pi, and after that we have to change the analytical branch of this logarithmic function. As a result, we have a similar expression which relate together two analytical branches of this integral. Okay, probably I avoid the detail of proofs. In the hyperbolic case, we have to understand that the fundamental group of the complement of knot has a representation to the group PSL2C. And as a result, if you can see the meridians and longitude of our knot, they are given after conjugation by quite simple matrices, where angle alpha is on the display, and gamma alpha is so-called complex length of our knots. And this gives a possibility to calculate a real length as a real part of this function, and as a result, by making use of the Schlafly formula to obtain the result. The similar consideration can be done also in spherical geometry. Now the image of our fundamental group is in SO4, which has to lift to the direct product of SO times SO2, and we have again pair of matrices which are completely responsible for our geometrical structure. Some calculations relate these parameters with length of our knots and so-called additional angle of rotation of lifting gamology. Okay, again, to do some calculations, we have to use some analytical equipment. This is coming through so-called a polynomial related with the knot. The properties of this a polynomial is well known, but in general, the structure of this a polynomial is oval. It's quite big. In order to avoid investigation of this large polynomial, we have to produce a very special statement, which for knot 5-2 is given in the following form. This is so-called cotangent theorem. So this means that the length of our knot and angle, con angle of our manifold, and the also angle of lifting gamology is related together by so-called cotangent relations. Z is exactly the root of the cubic equation mentioned above, and A is just fixed constant dependent on the angle. Indeed, this is just trigonometrical form of the a polynomial, which indeed is quite large. But this helps us to understand the structure of our knot from geometrical point of view. This is just a polynomial. After some suitable change of variables, namely these two, we have exactly this cubic equation. So this is more or less the meaning of the above statement, which I call cotangent theorem. Okay, very shortly, how to prove that this formula exactly gives us a volume. Okay, suppose that we have this integral. Is given very explicitly. Limit of integration at root of the cubic equation, so they are given. We know that limit of integration are exactly root of the integrand. If you put z1 or z2 inside, integral is equal to the zero. Integrand is equal to the zero. Again, by Schlafly formula, the derivative of this volume supposed to be L over 2. If this is valid, we have exactly the proof of our theorem. So we have to differentiate this expression with respect to alpha. What happens as a result? This is standard formula for differential. But I should remember that the z1 and z2 are roots of the integrand. So these two terms are zero. We have only one integral, which can be easily calculated. And now is the turn to use cotangent theorem. By cotangent theorem, these two expressions are exactly these two expressions in parentheses. After taking the difference between them, we have exactly L alpha over 2. So, from point of view of cotangent theorem, this is very elementary proof. But how to find the cotangent rule from the a polynomial, this of course is very long story, but now we can use this technique very explicitly. Okay, so this is more or less the ideas. Again, there is some just more particular investigation of this parameter, why we have to choose this exactly like parameters which are greater than minus one. This is because of geometry. We have one more root which satisfies this inequality, but quite possibly he has no geometrical meaning. at least I am not able to understand its geometrical meaning. And these two are enough to describe the situation very completely. Okay, so again, there is some very particular calculation because two-fold covering of this knot is length space of type 7.2. In turn, seven-fold covering of length space is three-dimensional sphere. So we have exactly this equality for the volume of our orbifold in the point P. This is just a particular case of the formula shown above. And the last equality for large alpha is just a changing of analytical branches of our integral. Okay, now I should say something more now about Euclidean volume. This is quite a new subject. This result are published just recently. And in this case, we are interested in the volume calculation for Euclidean structure. We know that Euclidean structure happens only for one particular value of this alpha, which is given on the slide. And in order to define the spherical volume correctly, we have to divide by the cube of length of our wet knot. So this is specific volume, reduced volume, or maybe some other words should be used. This theorem told us that this volume can be calculated very explicitly. This is just algebraic number, which is responsible for this analytical volume. How to prove this? We have to use just a formula for hyperbolic geometry, or maybe for spherical geometry, and find a limit of this expression when alpha is going to this particular angle. Very unfortunately, both sides of this expression are going to zero, so we have to use so-called L'Hopital rule to obtain the result. Differential of volume with respect to angle by Schlafly formula is exactly minus length over 2. And also we have a differential of the another expression. As a result, we have just calculated this expression. I should say that the length of knot is a very specific function. Its behavior in zero is like a square root of x. So his derivative is going to the infinity. So we're not able to find this limit very explicitly. But square of length is just an analytical function. Its behavior like x, like where x is given to zero. So we have to find just derivative of this expression. It's quite complicated, but it's just analytical function. Sooner or later, we have the result shown on our slide. The same calculations can be made also for another knots up to 7 crossing. The result will be shown later. I just prefer to give one more example. This is so-called knot 6.1, shown on this picture. We have a volume formula which is quite similar to the above formula, but in this case we have to use just one more square root to find the nice expression for this volume. This is hyperbolic volume, but similar formula is valid also for spherical volume. And then using the above mentioned limiting procedure, we have to find also a spherical volume for this knot. All results of calculations up to 7 crossings are given in the following table. This is a knot which was shown on the slide of Andrei Vesnin. This is the name of this knot. This is just slope. They, all of them are two bridge knots. This is a limit of hyperbolicity. This means up to this value, the knot has hyperbolic structure. Exactly in this point, it has a spherical structure, Euclidean structure, sorry. And after this, he has a spherical structure. This is specific volume related with the Euclidean case. All calculations are done very explicitly. So all of them are algebraic number. Every time we have to calculate a polynomial with integer coefficients, whose root are exactly these numbers. Well, so probably that's all what I want to say today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let us thank speaker. Questions from Zoom, please, first. Are there any questions?
Yeah, please.
То, что это алгебраические числа, это общий результат или просто
да,
получилось?
Now we have to prove a general.
Oh, sorry. The fact that the numbers are algebraic, is it general? Is it true for 15 crossings?
No. Now it's a theorem. It's not published yet. But it's
it's true. Uh-huh. It's so true. It's an observed, observed fact.
Yeah, it was 1 year ago, but now we have more general results, like you mentioned. Oh, yes.
I have a question.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
When you have a complex integral, is it true that you have always real number as a volume of manifold?
Sure,
maybe this is a complex number.
This is a positive number every time.
Real number.
This is surprise. Not real, just positive.
Why?
Positive. No, this is the nature of integral. Yeah, no, we integral are going to calculate a volume. We have just complex equipment to do this. This depends. You may use also real calculation, but it will be just more larger, more complicated. No, this is just complex analysis.
Volume always is a real number.
A real number, also positive number, greater than zero, not only real. You're right. But there are also some techniques to find so-called complex volume, which depends from two numbers. The real part is volume indeed, and the imaginary part is so-called Chern-Simons invariant. So indeed, we are able to use the same technique to find also Chern-Simons invariant for the above node. This is not done yet, but probably in few years we can do this also in very explicit form.